Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Sherwood Episcopal Church. I'm glad you are here with us, and I also welcome those who are joining us on Facebook Live. We are all one body in Christ. As is our standard, we have a few announcements before we begin our worship. Next week is a very important Sunday. It is called Welcome Sunday. We have it typically every September. But what's important about it is that we will be welcoming new members into our church community. And so I hope that you will come and join us in the festivities during the service. We will honor those, our new members, and then we will move to our church wing and enjoy fellowship and celebration. We are doing it a little differently than we have done in the past so that our friends from Facebook Live can enjoy and celebrate in the new membership of several members that will be joining our community this year. Also, I don't know if you had a chance to read in your e-news or in the bulletin about UCAN, but there is a dire need for $10 gift cards for the Dollar Tree. This is something that UCAN typically gives out to people who come in to seek help in either their electric bill or their rent. And this is a little something extra to give to an individual or his or her family. We are collecting funds. If you feel so desired, please put something in the offering market. We all have envelopes in the back for our offerings or for any kind of offering, so you can write your name, and also if it's cash, you can say please for UCAN or as my pledge, whatever it might be. But I encourage all of us to consider doing something, and I will be giving from my own discretionary account that you all support, so that will also help them out. And last, I think that was about it. There's many things in the bulletin that you need your attention, so take home the bulletin this week. Use the names or pray for the names of those who are on our prayer list now and our long-term prayer list, and also read the announcements and become updated. But now, let us take a few moments to settle our hearts and our minds and to be still, opening ourselves up to hearing God's Spirit in the hymns that we will sing, the scriptures that we will hear, and the prayers that we will offer up silently or aloud. I'm so glad you're here with us today. Thank you. Blessed be one holy and living God. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, to trust in you with all our hearts, for as you always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so you never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The first reading is from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 33, verses 7 through 11. You, mortal, I have made a sentinel for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked ones, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity. But their blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from their ways, and they do not turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity, but you will have saved your life. Now you mortal say to the house of Israel, thus you have said, our transgressions and our sins weigh upon us, and we waste away because of them. How then can we live? Say to them, as I live, says the Lord, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from their ways and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel? Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 119, verses 33 through 40. We will read responsively by whole verse. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall keep it to the end. Make me go in the path of your commandments, for that is my desire. Turn my eyes from watching what is worthless. Give me life in your ways. Turn away the reproach which I dread, because your judgments are good.
Second reading is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 13, verses 8 through 14. Owe no one anything except to love one another, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provisions for the flesh to gratify its desires. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Holy Gospel of Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said to his disciples, "If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall keep it to the end. Amen. Please be seated. I can remember years ago attending a vestry retreat. It was an opportunity for our church leadership to spend time together in fellowship and prayer and conversation. One of the discussions that we had was about the identity of the church. What makes the church and its community different from a social club or another nonprofit doing good works? Are we really any different? There was a long pause of silence when this question was asked. But soon people began to share what they believed to be the differences and the importance of their church community and why they intentionally chose to be its members. You know, on that day, I wish I had today's reading from Matthew in my back pocket, because it is a wonderful illustration of Jesus' understanding of what is unique about being a community of faith, a community that is vastly different from any social club or any nonprofit organization, and is essential in today's individualistic culture, where our personal rights often trump what is best for the greater good, for the greater of the community, or maybe even the world. In this passage, I don't know if you noticed, but Jesus isn't just suggesting, he is telling his faith community how to handle fractures in relationships. He knows us better than we know ourselves. While we might live in the dream that churches have no dissension, no arguments, nothing like that, he knows that we do and we will. After all, we are a community of human beings coming together to share our love with one another and with God. But that doesn't suddenly make us like Jesus. Unfortunately, it isn't that easy. It requires much more from us. It requires us to engage and relate to one another, especially those that we really don't like or don't even agree with. And it is much harder than being a part of a social club or a nonprofit organization. Our faith community is actually a way of life. It's a way of being. And Jesus is a patient leader. He lays it out clearly how conflict and disagreement should be handled in a faith community. It isn't about pushing things under the carpet and just being nice to one another, only to disparage our fellow member in the parking lot with a group of like thinkers. Conversations that we in the church call parking lot conversations that are often more counterproductive and harmful to any community. There truly is no wiggle room in Jesus's description of repairing the breach. It requires that whoever has hurt or offended us, we must first go and speak privately to them, sharing what is on our mind and, more importantly, what is on our heart. If there is no healing, no remorse, no apology, we continue to remain in conversation, bringing one or two others along with us so they can hear both sides. Perhaps something has gotten lost in translation, or one or both sides exaggerated a little bit too much. If that still doesn't work, we are to engage the entire community in the conversation. And if there still isn't a resolution and healing, that person may need to leave the community. Now, it doesn't mean that we have tarred or we are to tar and feather that person and ban them forever. Jesus always holds up the hope for repentance and reconciliation, and we must too. We also need to hear Jesus' description from the perspective of us hurting others. We may be willing to accept his instructions if we have been wronged, but are we willing to sit and listen to someone tell us how we have wronged or hurt them? Jesus is referring to both sides of the coin when it comes to disagreements and dissension. Regardless of which side we find ourselves, Jesus' instructions maintain a level of respect and kindness for all involved. Each step of reconciliation is handled with grace and dignity, or at least we hope. This isn't an opportunity to shame someone in front of everyone. No, this method by which everyone has a chance to act in a way that is trustful and truthful and honest and loving. And with each act, everyone has a chance to restore the relationship that impacts not just those two individuals or that group, but the entire community or a community of faith. If there is one lost sheep, we are all lesser for it as the body of Christ. It's ironic that just before this reading is the familiar story about that one lost sheep. The shepherd who goes out, leaving the 99 others to tend for themselves as he goes to look for that foolish little sheep that just wandered off. In our individualistic society and belief of the survival of the fittest, we may find that the shepherd's time spent searching is naive and maybe even wasteful. After all, there are 99 others who need watching and care. But the placement of this parable is perfect as Jesus enters into a conversation about reconciliation. Even for us, as we hear it today, everyone matters, even the ones who have wandered from the group, even the ones who have committed the crime. Everyone. Why? Because we are all redeemable. God created all of us, not just a select few. We are all have it within our hearts to be transformed, to see ourselves as children of God, not as insignificant or unlovable. Now, last week, if you remember, I challenged all of us about being keepers of the flame at this time in the life of the greater church. To be willing to live a life focused on the teachings of being a community of love, not a community that looks more like a social club. To be keepers of the flame means that we must take Jesus' guidelines for repairing the breach seriously. This is the outline for repentance, forgiveness, and healing. Now, my friends, it takes practice. We must listen. Not with the desire to say, yes, but to remain silent and listen deeply. Not to only hear the words, but actually feel them. To look into the eyes of the one speaking, letting our heart be open to hold the word and the words before conclusions are made. To ask questions, to be comfortable with the gaps of silence, where God may be speaking, and genuinely show love through our attentive listening. The Holy Spirit can do remarkable things when we invite her into the conversation. Hearts once broken begin to heal. What trapped us, our guilt, our anger, our questioning, can loosen its grip upon our heart and release us. A woman by the name of Mary Johnson did this, and it surprised her as much as it surprised the man who murdered her son, her only son. In 1993, Mary Johnson's life changed on a dime. Her son, Larriam Bird, was at a party that ended in a fight. He was shot and killed. He was only 20 years old. Mary recalls how during the trial, she stared at his killer, O'Shea Israel, who was just a boy of 16. She said she held such anger at the trial that all she wanted was her son to come back, and staring at the killer, his killer, enraged her. O'Shea was sentenced to 15 years. 12 years later, Mary again met her son's killer. They met at Stillwater Prison, and Mary remembers that when she saw O'Shea for the first time after all those years, She was no longer looking at a 16-year-old boy, but a man. During their time together, Mary began to share with O'Shea the story of her son's life, his short life, the dreams that she had for him that were never realized. And O'Shea remembers that when he heard Mary describe her son, suddenly her son became human. Maybe for the first time, O'Shea realized that what he did impacted not just himself having to serve a prison sentence, but the lives and dreams of so many others, especially this woman before him. When their time together was ending, Mary broke into tears, and O'Shea instinctively got up and hugged her. He said he hugged her as he would his own mother. Mary never forgot the hug. And after O'Shea was taken from the room, she remarked, "I just hugged the man that murdered my only son." And she said, instantly, I knew that all the anger, the animosity, all that stuff that I had in my heart for years for that man was over. I had totally forgiven him. O'Shea sometimes can't believe that Mary has forgiven him because he still hasn't forgiven himself. He admits it is something that he continues to learn from Mary because it is a part of the process of healing that he must go through. Now, upon O'Shea's prison release, they remained friends and even neighbors, living next door to one another for a period of time. And for Mary, it was an opportunity to experience the life of O'Shea when he graduated from college and all his other milestones, as if it was her only son. For O'Shea, Mary continues to be an inspiration and serves as his motivation to stay on the right path, because she believes in him. In his words, she is amazing, and her feelings for him are as equally as strong. Not every deeply fractured relationship ends like this. I hope you never have to experience the loss of a child at the hands of gun violence. But this is an example of the possibility of what can happen when who we think are the enemies, we begin to see them as humans. More importantly, Mary's forgiveness and O'Shea's redemption had ripple effects. It didn't just end with them. Mary began an organization from her own experience within her town called From Death to Life. And it's an organization that helps victims of gun violence heal and open ways for transformation, the same transformation that she herself experienced, and just what Jesus wants for all his beloved. Jesus is aware of how challenging life was for his followers and still is for us today. Yet he doesn't leave us with false promises. He leaves us with a strong foundation on which to build our community of love, to be keepers of the light, or as Paul referred to it in his letters to the Romans, to put on the armor of light. Because this higher calling allows us to live in love, not in fear, to be reconcilers, not destroyers, to be the light of hope and mercy, not of darkness and in despair and anger. And that is the world that needs us desperately. This is the world that we need to live in, not for a later day, not when it is convenient, but here, right now, this very moment. Amen. And now let us stand together to recite the Nicene Creed, as found on page 6 of your bulletin. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty,
the prayers of the people. In today's gospel, Jesus invites us to follow him as he laid down his life in intercession for the world. Let us pray on behalf of people everywhere, saying, Lord, strengthen us. For all people of faith who struggle to believe in the promise of life amid the clamor of death, we especially remember and give thanks for the life of Linda Parker, the grandmother of Anthony Parker, and pray for him as well as her three sons in their time of loss. Let us pray to the Lord. For the churches who must bear witness to the possibility of taking up the cross and following Jesus, let us pray to the Lord. For those who are losing their souls in the pursuit of worldly gain, let us pray to the Lord. For those laying down their lives in faithful dedication to God's call, let us pray to the Lord. For those who are to die this week and for their safe passage to the life of the world to come, let us pray to the Lord. For those on our parish prayer list, Josie, Chip, Raymond, Peggy, Sally E., Liz M., Kevin M., Victor, Joyce T., Kim, Bernie C., Tony Midge, Barbara, Joan L., Rachel, Doreen, Norma, Virginia, Don, Isla, Alec, Tom D., Josh F., Michelle G., Gretchen, Patricia, Mason, Herb and Sue, Catherine, Jessica, and Lane, as well as G, Let us pray. Let us pray to the Lord for the blessings of this life, for those celebrating anniversaries as well as birthdays, especially Larry Boucher. Let us pray to the Lord for all here present who will one day be judged by God's standards and meet Christ coming in glory. Let us pray to the Lord.
We also remember those who perished on 9/11 and their family and friends. Most High God, your ways are not our ways, yet your ways bear life. Hear the petitions of your assembled people. Pour out on your world the faith to hear your call and the courage to answer it. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who is one with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. And now let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy, we confess. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us greet one another in peace and our friends on Facebook Live. Peace. Peace, peace. Happy birthday, Larry. Woohoo! Walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and a good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining the angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices for all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us, and so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then, in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it. And he gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons with all your saints, past, present, and yet to come. We may praise your name forever. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to honor be glory and praise forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Body of Christ, the bread. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life, the cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. The wisdom of God and the love of God and the grace of God, may it strengthen you and may you be in Christ's hands and heart out in this world. In the name of the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Now, as we go forth into the world shouting hallelujah, refreshed and renewed, let us reaffirm our commitment to our mission as a congregation. God commands us to enthusiastically cast open our doors to embrace all, impacting lives through bold service, no exception. And now, my friends, let us go forth to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.